Hello everyone, this is Grace from KL University. Today in this vlog, I am going to discuss some of the topics that are in the course called Signal Processing. And the topics are sampling, Nyquist rate, quantization, discrete time signals and digital signals. So let's get started with sampling. Sampling means the word itself is telling us that it is going to divide something into a samples. So what it is going to divide? It is going to divide a continuous time signal into a discrete time signal. Continuous time signal means it is like a continuous wave-like structure. It is a wave-like structure without any breakdowns. Whereas discrete time signal means it has some breakdowns. Not as continuous, it has some breakdowns. So it is going to divide a continuous wave signal into a continuous time signal into a discrete time signal. So that is called as sampling, and the common example we can say is a conversion of sound wave into a sequence of samples. So we have a theorem regarding the sampling, and that theorem states that a continuous time signal can be completely represented in its samples and recovered back. So here we have a continuous time signal, and these are the samples. This is also called as impulse train, and these are the samples. We are converting this continuous time signal into the samples, and we are also getting recovered back. Like this is the sample frequency, you know. So if we joined all these points, we will be getting the original time signal. Means we are recovering back. So that is the statement is telling us a continuous time signal can be completely represented in its samples and recovered back. And only all this will be possible, only this condition satisfies. What is that condition? The condition is that fs greater than or equal to 2 fm. If this condition satisfies, then only all this process will be done. So what is fs? Fs means the sampling frequency, and fm means the maximum frequency of message signal. So here we need to discuss about the what is the maximum frequency. Here I'll be opening my notes. So here you can see what is the maximum frequency. This is the message signal x of t equal to sine 2 pi t plus sine 3 pi t plus sine 4 pi t. This is the message signal, and if we want to get the highest frequency in this message signal, we need to calculate, we need to divide that into the components. We have three components: sine 2 pi t, sine 3 pi t, sine 4 pi t. Those are the three components. We are dividing into the components and we are calculating the frequency, and we got 2 as the maximum frequency within the three components. So this is the 2 from what is the highest frequency? 2. So this is the fm. Fm equal to 2 from this example, from this message signal. So fm means the highest frequency. We have discussed about that theorem and what is the highest frequency, and this is the theorem. And coming to its techniques, we have three types of techniques in the sampling. What are those techniques? First one is impulse sampling, and second one is natural sampling, and third one is flat top sampling. So coming to the impulse sampling means only it is a product of input signal with impulse train. Already we discussed that this is the impulse train. So if we product that input signal with this impulse train, then we'll be getting some sampled frequency. So this process is known as impulse sampling. So the statement here, it is showing that y of t means the resultant. Y of t equal to x of t means the input. Impulse train means this is. So if we multiply this input signal with impulse train, then we'll be getting a sample frequency, that is y of t. And this process is known as impulse sampling. And next one, coming to the natural sampling, it is almost same as impulse sampling. But only the difference is that here the impulse train will be replaced by pulse train. Because it is a natural sampling, so the impulse train is replaced by pulse train, and all the process is the same. Same as the input signal will be multiplied by the pulse train, and we'll be getting the sample, the final resultant sampling. So this is the statement. And the last one, third one, is the flat top sampling. Flat top sampling is somewhat different from the first two sampling techniques. And what is that difference means? When a transmission pulse is going on, when we are getting a transmission pulse, some noise will be introduced at the top. So if we want, if to reduce that noise, we have a technique called as flat top sampling. In the flat top sampling, we'll be having that the pulse in the form of the flat top. So here you can see this. This is the flat top. This is in the rectangle shape. So if we place the pulse in a form of flat top, then the noise will be reduced. So the same as the difference between that first two techniques and this technique is that here the noise will be reduced because we are using the flat top. And these are the three sampling techniques. And now we are having we have discussed highest frequency sampling techniques. And now we have the Nyquist rate. Nyquist rate means we have a condition called as fs greater than or equal to 2 fm. So the minimum of that condition is the Nyquist rate. The minimum means fs equal to 2 fm, that is the Nyquist rate. That Nyquist rate means it is a minimum sampling rate at which signal can be converted into samples and can be recovered back without any distortion, and that is called as Nyquist rate. And this is the formula for Nyquist rate. And we also have a Nyquist interval also, and 1 fn into 1 fn is the Nyquist interval. And now we are getting into the quantization. What is quantization? Quantization means here this is an analog signal. So if the method of sampling, when we are when the sampling is occurred within this analog signal, then some points will be chosen by the sampling. So if we join all those points to get a round off value, and that process is called as quantization. And we are converting this analog signal into a digital signal. So to convert any analog signal into a digital signal, sampling and quantizing is must occur. So and the quantization of analog signal is done by discretizing the signal with a number of quantization levels. There will be some levels within the quantization, and that quantization is representing the sampled values of the amplitude by a finite set of levels, which means converting a continuous amplitude sample into a discrete time sample. So the finally quantization means the sampling when converting analog signal into a discrete signal, I mean digital signal. So that quantization, that sampling will choose some points. And if we join all those points, then that process is known, joining all those points to get a round off value, and that process is known as quantization. And here you can see in this graph, the blue line is an analog signal, and the brown line shows us the how an analog signal gets quantized. So the final resultant quantized signal, which is in the form of digital form. Firstly, it is in the form of analog signal, and finally, after going through the process of quantization, the final graph will be like this. And we have two types of quantization. One is uniform and other one is non-uniform. In the uniform, again we have mid-rise and mid-thread. So just a small difference between uniform and non-uniform quantization is that in uniform the quantization levels are uniformly spaced, whereas in non-uniform the quantization levels are non-uniformly spaced. That is the small difference. And also coming here, we have in uniform we have mid-rise and mid-thread also. So just a small difference between mid-rise and mid-thread we can observe from this graph itself, like a small difference at its origin only. And next, coming to discrete time signals, as at the first of this presentation only I have mentioned about discrete time signals and continuous time signals. So as I said, discrete time signal means it has some breakdowns, like not as a continuous wave signal, it has some breakdowns. So discrete time signal in here, in this graph, in this picture, we are seeing that the red marks are the discrete time signals. Actually, the discrete time signals, we can get that from continuous time signals also. The source is not important here, but the thing which we need to focus is that continuous time signal can be represented as a function, but whereas discrete time signal cannot be represented as a function. That is the only difference, or that is the only important point we need to remember. So that is the discrete time signal. And coming to the digital signals, is that digital signal, it is also a signal which represents data as a sequence of discrete values. As we have mentioned in the discrete time signals, here digital signal is a signal which represents data as a sequence of discrete values, and it only take one value from a finite set of possible values at a given time. And these four are some examples in which we can see the digital signals. And the mostly used or mostly most given example with the digital signals is that the graph between voltage and time. When we plot a graph between voltage and time, the digital signals are only one of the two values, that is 0 or 0 volts or VCC. So actually digital signals will be used in all the digital electronics, but mostly we can say this example to get to know better. And finally, the advantages and disadvantages of the digital signals. So here we have 3 advantages and 2 disadvantages. These are the most common occur advantages and disadvantages, but we have many. Coming to the advantages, digital signals can convey information with less noise, distortion, means we can say that without any noise and distortion and interference of any other signals. And digital circuits can also be reproduced in mass quantities, especially within the low cost. And the third advantage we can say is that DSP, digital signal processing, can be used alter digitally programmable systems also. And coming to the disadvantages, as it is digital communication, so to transmit when compared to the analog transmission, a higher bandwidth is required for digital time signal. And also DSP means digital signal processing, that processes the signal at high speeds and comprises more top internal hardware resources. So these are some of the advantages and disadvantages of the digital signals. And we get to know that what is a sampling theorem, what are the sampling techniques, and how we get Nyquist rate from that sampling theorem, and also quantization and the types of quantization and discrete time signals, and also finally the digital signals and its advantages and disadvantages. From this, with this, I am concluding my blog. I hope this is informative. Thank you for watching.